So, I'll read the text slowly. This is a long poem, and what I'm doing is commenting on this poem section by section. So I'll read what we have already covered, and I'll focus on the following. So it'll take several talks in this series. So this is an 8th century text in the Chan Zen tradition by Chan Master or Zen Master Yongjia Xuanjue. The previous talks are available on YouTube, so you can catch up. So the text goes, "Have you not seen those people of the way who have nothing to learn and nothing to do? They neither discard wandering thoughts nor seek the truth. The true nature of fundamental ignorance is Buddha nature. The illusory empty body is the Dharma body. After realizing the Dharma body, there is not a single thing. Your original, intrinsic nature is the authentic, innocent Buddha." So that's where we left off. So today, I'll try to cover several lines. The text continues. The five skandhas, aggregates, are the illusory comings and goings of floating clouds. The three poisons of greed, hatred, ignorance are the transient appearing and disappearing of bubbles on ocean's surface. When true reality is actualized, realized, there are no personhood or dharmas. The karma of Avicii hell is destroyed in a kshana, instant. If I were to lie to deceive sentient beings, may my tongue be ripped out for kalpas, eons, unaccountable as dust and sands. With sudden awakening to the dhyana of the Tathagatas, the Buddhas, the six paramitas, perfections, and the myriad practices are perfected in their essence. In dreams, there are clearly six destinies of sentient beings in samsara. Upon awakening, the great chiliocosm is completely empty. So I'll try to speak up to this point here. So, a recap. This text can be said to be one of the formidable texts in the whole Chan Zen tradition. The tradition during this time was emerging as a self-conscious movement against Buddhist scholasticism. And also, this text is quite radical. Quite radical. And we'll get to that tonight. It's radical because it dismantles foundational Buddhist teachings. Or rather, deconstructs them. Not in an analytical way. Yongjia is sharing his personal experience after great thorough awakening. And It's radical because not only it shakes the foundation of foundational Buddhism, but also the very foundation of how we normally carry ourselves in daily life, our impulses. So like all of you come to the meditation, you want to maybe be free from stress and gain some peace in your life. So people usually come to the practice because they have some anguish, suffering, challenges in life, and they engage in practice to gain some peace of mind. Not that this is wrong, but this is only the beginning. And the Buddhist path lays out a trajectory that gets down to the very core of our existence. So it's not about only, you know, being happy, having some calm and peace, removed from the chaos of daily life. It's actually about questioning our existential identity, who we are. And the meaning of this existence. Okay? Questioning the impulses of seeking, rejecting, love and hate, grasping, suppression, all of these dualistic tendencies. Because these tendencies lie at the core of our suffering, our challenges. So if we examine all the painful experiences that we had, and we've had many, right? Yes? No? Okay. If we examine the fundamental and the mechanism that propels us to experience negativities, then we see that what lies at the core is this tendency of grasping, rejecting, seeking, relinquishing, wanting, hating, this polarity. Is what moves us, drives us in positive ways, but also is the basis of our suffering. So Buddhism has a whole elaborate system of causes of suffering. But what lies at the core is, very simply, we want this moment to be other than what it is. So we already have an ideal that we want, and this is not it. So grasping and rejecting. Our rejection, our resistance, is what causes suffering. It's not to say that we should accept everything, but to penetrate this habit tendency, one examines oneself, there's even something behind that. There's something behind our seeking and rejecting, having and lacking, wanting this moment to be other than what it is. And that is our perpetual sense of self-referentiality, self-referencing, the sense of self. And this is the target of the whole Buddhist project of dismantling suffering and its causes. The whole Buddhist project can be understood as, typically, all textbook version talks about, the Four Noble Truths, suffering, cause of suffering, cessation, and the path. They're basically two sets of cause and effect. Suffering, the cause, grasping, rejecting, seeking, relinquishing, love and hate. This is the cause of suffering. Put it simply, we want this moment to be other than what it is. No matter what this moment we're facing. So that's the cause. Is there a way out? Yes. The latter set of cause and effect. Cessation is the effect. The cause is the path, practice. Now what lies beneath this is typically what is called beneath this grasping, rejecting, this polarizing tendencies that we have, is a sense of self. How it manifests is this polarity. Right? Together, that's called the three poisons. Right? Greed, aversion, polarity, stemming from fundamental ignorance. Not low intelligence. Ignorance of how true reality is. And that true reality is, there is no self. The self is a construct of confluence of different causes and conditions, ever changing, ever renewing. But our tendency is to solidify this, fixate our sense of who we are. That's where the suffering comes from. So this text, in a sense, does not say anything new, but it is radical in the way that it expresses it in a very straightforward, blunt way. Based on this great master's personal experience. So he had already digested the teachings, not on an intellectual level, but he has personally testified this. So this is his poem of awakening. So I spoke about the different technical terms, nothing to do, nothing to learn. This refers to one who is awakened, right? These are technical terms. Why would he not try to get rid of wandering thought and seek after truth? Because he's awakened. This very tendency of grasping, rejecting, including even our grasping onto the teachings and seeking awakening, that itself is a form of delusion. So realizing that this fundamental ignorance, not seeing how things actually are, and still swirled about by causes and conditions, by this tendency, this polarizing tendency within us, once freed, then so-called Buddha nature, our true nature of awakening, that we are already free, cannot be gained by something outside, cannot be understood through words and language, definitely cannot be obtained by following, grasping and rejecting, having and lacking, seeking, rejecting. Therefore, after realizing the Dharma-body, the body of reality, last week I spoke about Dharma-body through the lens of understanding our own physical body, which people have all kinds of relationship with their own body. Some run away from it, some are completely divorced by it, some are not in tune with their own bodies, and how that shifts and influences the way we perceive things, right? Our bodies. Some are caught up with body image. Some have certain notion of the body. All these things, right? By seeing through the veil of these constructs, the text says it's not a single thing. It's not a single reified thing. Now, our tendency is to make everything into a thing. That's another colloquial way of saying attachment. So everything we make it into a thing. Once it becomes a thing, then there's subject-object. Then there's reification, solidification. Then there's definitely having, lacking. I want this, I don't want that. Does that make sense? The whole vicious cycle begins. In truth, there's not a single thing. We make it into a thing. Now this thing could be ideas, notions, opinions, or material things. Everything constantly renews itself. Their nature is possibilities. Their nature is freshness, new beginnings. But we tend to hold on to these ideas, thereby causing ourselves trouble. So I finished with this original nature, freedom, is our authentic innocent Buddha. So today, the text further talks about the five skandhas. How many of you have never heard the word skandhas? Raise your hand. Okay. Have not. Okay. Skandhas is a Sanskrit word. It simply means heaps, aggregates. So it's a way ancient Indian Buddhist conceive of as a human being. So instead of the Cartesian notion of body versus mind, the Buddhist does not have this dualistic concepts. He conceive of a human being as comprised of five different aggregates, five different parts. Form, sensation, perception or conception, volition, action, and consciousness, cognitive moments. So all of us are constituted by these five aggregates. Within each aggregate there, you can split them up into other finer details, like form. We're constituted by earth, water, fire, and wind. These are metaphorical ways to talk about the sense of solidity, fluidity, bodily heat, and breath. Right? So four elements. Sensation, there are all kinds of sensations that we have, but at the very raw fundamental level, there are three possible variations. In each instant, momentary instant. So pleasant, unpleasant, and neutral. Out of these, there's a whole array of different sensations. And on a physiological level, in an embodied way, very often these sensations actually shapes our conception, our perception, which is the next aggregate, the next skanda. This pertains to words, language, labels, judgments, discriminatory functions. Okay. And lastly, we have consciousness. Right. Consciousness has two parts. One, it pervades the first three skandhas: sensation, perception or conception, and volition. Volition means action. Right? On the basis of our experience, we react, body, speech, and mind. So consciousness, part of its function, is it pervades the first three. You can't have sensation without consciousness. You can't have conception or action without consciousness. Right? Second part of the function of consciousness, it serves as a repository, like a vessel. So this is metaphorically speaking. So every action that we create leaves a karmic impression. Karmic impression in our mental continuum. It's not something fixed. It's more like habituation, right? Habituation. So metaphorically, the Buddhists talked about consciousness as a kind of repository of these karmic impressions. They conceived of this as seeds. It's like planting seeds. If you have a lot of seeds, apple seeds, then most likely you have apple trees, right? So if you have, some other type of seeds, then the right causes and conditions will bring about the fruition. So these karmic seeds, now they seem like nouns, like fixed things, right? But really they're like habits, tendencies, right? So the second function of consciousness serves as a repository of these seeds or potentials in our mental continuum, right? Which has its own logic of cause and effect. Essentially, this is to say that nothing comes out of nothingness. Right? Every action that we make, there are causes and conditions. There are reasons why we are the way we are. Now, why we are the way we are is through our actions, and our actions are mediated by our conception. Conception is mediated by our physiological embodied experiences based on our form. Right, so they're all intricately connected. So there's an internal chain of cause and effect happening. The way we see things come from our habit. Why do we have this habit? Because we keep on doing the same thing over and over. Or we keep on experiencing the same conditions that shapes us, right? Whether it's individual, through our family, through our society. Right? So they leave these karmic imprints that have shaped us. Does that make sense? So that's the five skandhas. So the text says the five skandhas are like illusions, comings and goings of floating clouds. Basically, it's saying that however we think how solid we are, we can feel ourselves, our body, this is me, feels pretty permanent. Actually, it's constantly undergoing changes. And it continues to shape our experiences, our perceptions, our choices. So this deals with what I spoke about last talk, relationships and new beginnings. So the Buddhist practice can be said about to be about relationships. The way we relate to ourselves, the way we relate to the four elements, this body, we relate to our experiences, the way we reify, solidify certain notions, or we're free from these tendencies of fixation. Right? Changes the qualities of our experience. Right? So, in that sense, they are like illusions, right? Continually changing. And the metaphor here is like floating clouds. Okay. Now, if we examine again our experiences, our challenges, the difficulties we have at work, family, friends, our partners, or ideological disagreement on views, which is the most dangerous, right? Attachment, not necessarily to the body, attachment to views, to ideas, ideologies, most dangerous. Right? When we run into these experiences of attachment, there's something there. There's always something there that it's not like floating clouds that change. You know, formations of clouds constantly change. Right? When we examine our experiences, we don't operate this way. We operate just the opposite. Concrete, solid opinions. Hence, that's the beginning of our suffering and the perpetuation. Whenever there's conflict, disagreement, when we feel hurt, when we feel not seen, not heard, not valued, there's some kind of fixation there that won't budge. So that is the formation of self. Through attachments, self come into being. Boundaries are created. Disagreements are formed. Okay. So, when a person realizes the true nature of who we are, which is free, instant by instant by instant, originally liberated, this term will be wisdom of selflessness. Then there would be no fixations. Then floating clouds. So five skandhas will constitute us. Right? Our body becoming sick. Our bodies deteriorate. Right? Falls apart. But because of our idea, we want this body to be other than what it is. Fixation and the suffering. Right? But the body constantly goes through changes. So our sense of happiness, if it's rested on objects of our attachment, then we're in trouble. You see? So our experiences are no longer free, liberating, but we become tethered, bound by the objects that we attach to. Objects could be things, could be ideas, could be notions. Then all kinds of problems come. One of the ways, like I said earlier, the self manifests is this polarizing tendencies, right? And I call that the three poisons. Greed, aversion, coming from fundamental ignorance, delusion about who we are. So the next line says, the three poisons, these three poisons, which cause of our suffering, are the transient appearing and disappearing of bubbles on the ocean surface. It's like froth. Is it called froth? Yeah. Insubstantial. Okay. So, the person is no longer bound by these the three poisons. Now, this is, these words are said by someone who is thoroughly awakened. Right? When we examine our experiences, it's just the opposite. You know, we experience greed, aversion, delusion, all kinds of vexations. Right? So these words become a kind of principle for us. Principle, a guideline to share with us our true nature. Our true nature. So it's very empowering. Now, you can take these words as maybe disheartening. It's like, oh my gosh, it's so difficult. All I experience is greed, hatred, ignorance. You know, it's so difficult. It's so lofty, unreachable goal. Or you can take it as empowering, because the main message is, originally, we are now bound by the three poisons. That's not our true nature. So, due to our misconceptions of who we are and the world, we develop erroneous views and we attach to them. Now, where do these views come from? Our child rearing process, the way we're educated, the way we come up with these notions. So the whole world unfortunately is in on it, conditioning us, perpetuating the three poisons. It promotes polarization. It promotes opposition. It creates divisions. So it's up to us. Do we want to be conditioned by biased views, polarizing opinions? Can we see through the veil, the constructedness, the fabrication of these notions? And to what extent do we want that to influence our judgment and our opinions of ourselves and all of our brothers and sisters in this world, right? Our choices that we make. So this whole world, every aspect of this world is perpetuating this. So we are going against the grain. in a sense. So in this sense, it's radical. This world promotes division. Like nations. The earth doesn't divide, oh, that's Canada, and this is America, and that's Italy, and this is, you know, some other place. We're the one, through wars, through conflict, aggression, divide up this pie of earth. Right? And what's driving it is greed. Aversion, fundamental ignorance, delusion of not knowing how things actually are, how we are intimately connected, each and every one of us. Right? How everything is renewing itself. Right? Instead, we operate in a way we want to fix ideas. We invent notions of race. You know, to compartmentalize, categorize, to judge different people. The same thing that we do in our ordinary lives. We compartmentalize, this is a friend, that's a foe. Because this person says something bad to me, so that's the enemy. I don't like that. This person looks a certain way. And that person, I don't really care. Neutral. Right? Friend, foe, neutral. See? All the ways that we divide, the thrust of which is our self-referentiality. And that is the target of Dharma practice. To see through the veil through which we've blinded ourselves and continue to blind, to participate in the world that blinds everyone. That's why we engage in practice. Right? So the word Buddha means awake, to wake up from the slumber of the three poisons that we perpetuate. So there's actually genuine peace and compassion. Does that make sense? Compassion arises because we realize the intimate connections that we have with each other. It's not because some new Buddhist doctrine tells us to be compassionate, so we let everyone take step all over us. No, it comes from genuine practice and experience of how things actually are. We're connected. And this business about your five skandhas over there versus my five skandhas. Mine looks younger, yours is older and decrepit. And mine is really tall, and the color of my skin is a certain way, and yours is another way. And these notions of three poisons. So this business about five skandhas, our body and mind, right? Mine. And what drives this, the three poisons, is completely delusional. Like floating clouds. Like froth. So in examining our own suffering and the suffering of the world, our society, North America, now, the past year and a half, you know, been experiencing racial reckoning. Right? Centuries of discrimination against black people, people of color. Right? This dates back to, you know, a long time. Human civilization, it's not only several centuries. Human civilization, we invent ways to divide people. Right? Slavery is not new. Slavery is, every civilization has slavery. Right?
driven by the three poisons. Dismantle this. Now, first, dismantle it in ourselves. The way we divide ourselves, disembody ourselves, disassociate ourselves from our own bodies. How are we relating to our body? How are we treating our body? I spoke about that last talk. So here it talks about the body, five skandhas, right? The delusion of the five skandhas and the three poisons of separateness. And the text goes, when true reality is actualized, these are technical terms, but we can understand it simply as, when you're awakened, there is no personhood or dharmas or phenomena, discrete things. That's what dharmas is, discrete things, this versus that, white versus black, good versus bad. Everything is made up of everything else. This building that we sit, the roof that we sit, the center is made up of everything else. Wood floor, wood structure, the architect, the design, where does the money come from? Everyone else. You could say, okay, Guo Gu raised the money to build the center, but Guo Gu is not rich. The money comes from everyone else. It belongs to everyone else. It belongs to everyone. Right? We ourselves, say me, oh, this is my body. You belong to the four elements. You belong to the world. You belong to everyone. So it becomes natural to repay the gratitude of the nourishment that we received from everyone in our lives and all the people seemingly unconnected to us, our predecessors, previous generations. Right? So seeing this, experiencing this, dismantles this notion of personhood, me, I, mine, which is the manifestation of what? Three poisons, right? And discrete things, right? Dharmas. Once we dismantle this, then we see the next line. The karma of Avicii hell. Avicii hell is one of the worst hells in Buddhist cosmology. Right? It's not unique to Buddhism. This notion of Avicii hell, different groups of spiritual practitioners pre-Buddha's time, during Buddha's time, and post-Buddha's time have their own interpretation of what Avicii hell constitutes. Right? There's in Buddhism, there's eight different hells. Avicii is the worst. Right? Endless torment. Now, what gets us there? People have all kinds of ideas. Right? From Buddhist perspective, the five heinous transgressions gets us to be reborn in Avicii hell. Right? Shedding the blood of the awakened one, Buddhas. Slandering the three jewels. Killing an arhat. Matricide. Five heinous crimes or heinous transgressions that plunges you into hell. Right? But we don't need to see this as a literal description of cosmology. The fact that everyone has their own idea of what Avicii Hell is and how we get there shows that this term is very fluid, right? And there's also a sociological component to this. Right? So this text is about 8th century. 8th century is the beginning. Buddhism went to China about 1st century, 2nd century, 3rd, 4th, 5th. It already became integral to Chinese civilization and ideas. So these notions of hell scared the bejesus out of the Chinese. Right? And the Chinese original idea of health is just like you die and you have like, again, varying conceptions. Some say there are two kind of souls. One goes up, one goes down. There's kind of theories of seven souls. There's like these different texts from pre-modern time, BCE times, right? So when the Buddhist comes in with this systematized notion of health and particular acts that leads to what hell, like a matching game, right? The Chinese, by the 8th century, came up with notions, indigenous notions, very Chinese notions of bureaucracy of hells called purgatories. This is the emergence of ideas of what is called the 10 kings of hell. How many of you have heard of that? Google it. 10 kings of hell. The Chinese are just bureaucrats, right? So they conceive of the earthly realm mimicked in the unseen realm, whether it's gods or hells and heavens and so on. Right? Milsen's looking at me like, what is he talking about? The bureaucratization of cosmology, the Chinese, right? For example, there's gods for the stove, there's gods for cooking, there's gods for like famous people, generals, that done great for the civilization. They become apotheosized after several generations. They become hell. And what position do they hold? They hold the equivalent position that they had when they were living, except in the unseen realm. The whole bureaucracy leading up to the Jade Emperor, which is like the top head honcho of celestial realm. Right? The Taoists would have a whole conceptions about this. So this is the indigenous conception. Right? Coupled with the Buddhist cosmology of the six realms of existence, the Chinese, like what they do with everything, they bureaucratized it. 10 kings, you gotta pass by the kings which they hold the karmic mirror in case you lie. Say, I didn't do that. I didn't kill anyone. Actually, we have a recording on the VHS here. Let me press play for you. So this karmic mirror replicates, right, exactly your actions, and you're judged. So there are these 10 courts. This is the emergence. So now Yongjia, during this time, the first thing that he dismantles is this. Right? First, he goes over the traditional Buddhist notion, five skandhas, you know, attachments, three poisons. And then he tackles this, you know, the no self, dharma. And then he says, Avicii hell? Destroyed in an instant if you're awakened. These constructs that people create, right? Is it the Buddhist? Which one is right? The Buddhist way, or the Jains, or the Tathantakas, or the, you know, all these kind of mendicant traditions during the Buddhist time, or maybe the Western Judeo-Christian, maybe they got it right. There are no different type of hell. It's just, you know, heaven and hell. You know, who got it right? These conceptions, these notions, created by the fears, by the poisons of the mind. Right? Now, it's not to say there are no such thing. These are pure
metaphors. That's another conception in our shared repertoire of science. Right? We think in our shared understanding, looking back, oh, they're just metaphorical. That's just the same as those people who take it literally. People have different shared understanding in different era, different periods of time. Right? So neither deny nor affirm. But we understand that the karma, the actions that create and perpetuate these realms of existence that we live in, living and dead. These actions that create them are completely dismantled once we awaken. Right? The text is not saying Avicii hells are empty. It's saying the karma of Avicii hell are destroyed. Right? Why does it say that? Because the psychic powers of our minds through generations and centuries, countless people conceive of a reality of a particular way, that reality will come into being. That reality will come into being. Now imagine centuries, millennia of people conceiving of notions of heaven and hell, and there's a God. And they pray to it. By the collective energy and generations of humanity praying to a particular God, that God will come into being. That's the energy of the people. Now, millennia of people conceiving of realms of existence, the six realms will come into being. It may not come into being in the way we fashion them, we may understand them, right? But just like everything else that we conceive of, that we can imagine, the limits of our imagination, the limits of our conception, brought into being, all the privileges that we have living in the 21st century. The divisions that we have, the categories that we create, race, right? Ethnicity, you know, privilege, underprivilege, these categories will continue to shape our experience and our actions of body, speech, and mind, mediated by these experiences, will create the realities that we conceive. Right? So, the karma of Avicii hell is destroyed in an instant. Why? Because the mechanism of karma, which rests on me, I, mine, lies in the center of our actions, dismantled. Self-referencing, dismantled. Thereby, greed, hatred, and ignorance, dismantled. All the actions that now stem from this person is no longer self-referential. It's based on compassion. So the world that this person lives in becomes the Buddha land. Even in the same space that we are in, right? Each of us live in our own constructed reality. Does that make sense? So we have our shared repertoire of notions and ideas and conceptions, cosmology, and each of us also have our own individual karmically shaped world that we specifically live in, that conditions the way we see things, interpret ideas, judge certain people. So he continues, if I were to lie and deceive sentient beings, may my tongue be ripped out for kalpas, uncountable as dust and sand. So basically saying he's not lying. So the experience of the awakened person transcend the bounds of the six realms of existence. And that's what follows next, in the next four lines, which I'll cover next time. So we'll end here tonight. Right? So tonight, we talked about the five skandhas, the three poisons, selflessness, and the absence of discrete dharmas, things. We spoke about avicii hell, and the actions that create this reality, destroyed in an instant. All right, any questions? What's the takeaway? Is this text trying to scare the bejesus off? No, it's to dismantle that. It's dismantling. You're already free. But don't become tethered by the conditioning which shaped your experience. Be free from your habit tendencies of greed, hatred, ignorance. Through this lens that you process everything in the world. Don't do that. Free yourself from this. Is that the takeaway? Anyone else? Something that stuck out for you? Gita.
You mentioned that the strength of people's beliefs, generations' beliefs, they actually call things into being. So to what extent does our personal belief in something,
So there are several questions embedded in that question. So for those of you on Zoom, how does individual conceptions mediate our experience in the afterlife? Right? Avicii hell, everything. Right? It depends on the fortitude and strength of the psychic energy. I don't mean something mysterious like psychic. What I mean is the energy of your mind. Energy of your mind. So most people, untrained in meditation practice, focus, and so on, their mind is just scattered. So easily influenced. Like a hypnotist. Hypnotist influences most people's mind like that. They put you to sleep. Right? If your mind is very strong, they can't put you to sleep. That's an easy to understand example. So the strength of one's mind, will, is connected to samadhi. Right? Concentration power. So if one is oblivious to these notions of VG hell, this and that, it's hard to say, right? It depends on the individual mind. You know? Now, if an individual mind is very strong and they put their mind to something, to task, they will accomplish it. And the energy of different minds will start to be influenced by this mind. Right? So the mind is geared towards compassion, is geared towards the benefit of all beings, then the presence of this person will start to influence other minds to good. Likewise, if the mind is corrupt, greed, hatred, ignorance, very strong, that will also influence other minds. Right? Does that make sense? Now this mind, living in a culture, civilization that believes in six realms of existence, you know, blah, blah, blah. Whether that person believe it or not, if the person's mind is weak, they will probably be influenced by the whole collective energy in humanity, created through millennia, right? So the force is quite strong. So I don't want to scare you guys. Oh my God, I'm fighting against the whole humanity. I got to free myself from samsara. Oh gosh, how do I do that? Practice chan. Right? So some of you, when you're sat, you know, you're influenced by wandering thoughts. The first thing is not be influenced. The comings and goings of the clouds. I just focus on the method. Body relaxed, grounded, and experience. With every method, there's a key. There's a knack to it. Right? Every kind of discipline, martial arts, meditation, you know. So you have to kind of understand the principle, how to work with it. Right? And then you cultivate. More and more, you become less and less manipulated, influenced, conditioned by the habit, our own habit tendencies of greed, hatred, ignorance, and all those, you know, vexations, right? Less and less influence, pure and pure and pure and pure. So the presence of your mind becomes strong. And we rely on everyone else collectively. Right? Like all of you. We practice together. It's different. So someone come into the meditation hall. This meditation hall is built in 2017. Right? You come into this meditation hall, you feel different. Why? Because the energy, the presence of all these people practicing here is different. A space, you know, like a church, cathedral, you know, high ceiling. It's not only beautiful, there's a presence there. Why? Collective prayer, collective concentration is there. So you go to a place, you feel the presence of the place, you see? So it's important to practice with the group and steer our mind, purify it from the poisons. See through the veil, dismantle the sources of suffering for humanity. Start with ourselves. That is something so worthwhile. That gives meaning to something much greater than this me, I, mine. Constantly trying to get somewhere, right? For the sake of humanity, for the possibility of a future, because we're intimately connected. So that is a purpose. That is a direction in life. Agreed? Yeah. And the kind of gratitude that we feel from having the fortune to come across this path. Don't get caught up with the samsara, six realms of existence, you know, all these different cosmological things. the main point about karma, is responsibility. Responsibility. I'll speak on a little more about this next time. Karma or vijja. What's the point of Buddhist notion of karma? The sense of responsibility and the sense of connection we have with others and our kind of collective commitment to practice. So that is something so invaluable. So invaluable. That's my takeaway from this. Okay? All right. Folks on Zoom? It's all good? Okay. All right. See you all next time.